what is your assessment, if you analyze all those policies, have those interventionist policies failed or succeeded to achieve their stated goals?
Well, we if we see in the past when US got independence back in 1783, and we see that it adopted the policy of isolationism. It it kept itself away from the, you know, whatever was going on, be it World War One or Two, and other things that were going on at that time in the European region. So it adopted that policy, and maybe this is the reason that United States developed at that fast pace. We know, the students of IR know very well that after World War II, we saw that Hiroshima Nagasaki occurred, and America broke into the platform of the world, and with that entry, then we saw the Cold War era, and in that Cold War era, we see there were two distinct blocs in the world. One was the communist bloc, and the other was the US-led bloc. Throughout this Cold War era, we see that there were many interventions led by United States of America. For example, it invaded Vietnam, it invaded Korea, and all that was going on throughout the Cold War period. After Cold War, and even now, we see that US has been engaged in proxy wars and sort of indirect interventions, or maybe the direct one, direct ones, but definitely in the name of collective security or through the, you know, platform of NATO. So we see that after breaking its isolationist policy, it has been actively engaged in different parts of the world. And still, we can see in case of Middle East, in case of South China Sea, as you were mentioning, America is quite active in all these areas and in all these conflicts. So I think this is its basic policy, to stay engaged in all these conflicts and all these issues,
and to maintain its global dominance.
Hegemony, yeah.
Right. What are those key strategies which the US is employing right now to maintain that global dominance in the face of rising powers such as China or shifting alliances?
First of all, if we see that, as we have seen in, throughout the Cold War era, that it has engaging different countries, giving them financial or, you know, monetary benefits or some developmental funds, and using the techniques of sanctions, etc. Also alliances making, using the platform of NATO and all that. Mufti Saab was talking about how it's impossible or it's difficult to stop US in the given context of Israel-Palestine conflict. So he was mentioning one aspect, that Muslim Ummah is not united, and definitely there are sectarian crises like Sunni Shia and, you know, everything going on, Iran, Iraq, and Saudi Arabia-Iran conflicts. And overall, if we see that Muslim countries in the Arab world are getting incentives from different. So that could be the one reason that we are unable to stop America. There are many other factors, such as the rise of Russia, such as the rise of China, that are also involved in Palestine and Israel, that particular Middle Eastern area region. So these are also the factors. Also, there are non-state actors which are actively engaged in this, making US unstoppable. So I think these are the other aspects that I would like to add.
And also, what we are doing, are we really working on ourselves? Like he mentioned, it's all about technology. It's all about those advancements and innovations these days. We seem to be lagging behind.
I think this is one of the most important reasons. If we see back in 1970, when oil was discovered in the Middle East, and, you know, before that, they were living hand to mouth, and they didn't have financial strong base. But after 1970, we saw that it became the bone of contention for all over the world because of that oil, and, you know, the controversies after petrodollar and involvement of many you know, greater powers in the Middle East. Oil was the major reason. So I think if we see the current situation, as you have mentioned, the major reason behind it is that we are dependent on the technologies that we are buying from the Western world, but we are not investing on making our own on our own technology.